We'll now go on to Evelyn Khor. She has a very specific example of her involvement, and I'd like to her to take the floor.
I'm going to share screen because I have PowerPoint slides. I'm going to speak from my slides. I just want to thank Mary for highlighting, you know, definitions of what is participatory democracy, and how, you know, the power of one. So I'm going to talk about a very specific example. Okay. Okay. I think you can see my screen. I'm going to talk about participatory democracy and empowerment of the citizen in terms of my involvement in the Taman Tun Dr. Ismail Community Garden. My example is slightly different from Mary's. I'm going to talk about specifically how, as individuals, we can actually, we are actually empowered to change certain things, policies, or whatever you think should be changed, but you have to take an active role and not just sit back and say, I'll wait for my MP or wait for somebody to do something. So my example will be about the Taman Tun Dr. Ismail Community Garden. People outside Kuala Lumpur will not know what's this place, Taman Tun Dr. Ismail, but you would have read about it because recently we had a landslide victory because we were fighting to save a piece of land that was a reserve, a park for the residents. And that battle went on for 7 years, where we took KL City Council to court because they had regazetted the land, which was parkland, and they wanted to build blocks of condominiums with the excuse that they were providing housing for some longhouse residents who had been there for a long time. Okay, so that went on for many years, and in the end, we won. So that is an example in our area, in our taman, about participatory democracy and citizenship empowerment. But I'm not going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about something else, which is a community garden, the Taman Tun Dr. Ismail Community Garden. Okay. Now, how it all started, this was in what you're seeing is 2017, around that time. But this has been there for years. This piece of land, now it's not outside Taman Tun, it's within the housing area. And if you know Taman Tun, land is very, very valuable. Okay. So it was an eyesore, because surrounding this piece of land are single-story houses and some double-story houses. Now, we're talking about houses which are facing this piece of land. Those houses are worth about $1.3 million, and they are single-story. So we were very concerned because when we went to City Council, nobody wanted to tell us what they were going to do with this piece of land. Everybody just said, don't know. We were afraid they were going to build high-rise apartments on that piece of land. It's about 16,000 square feet, right? Big piece of land. And when we went to Jabatan Landscape Negara, nobody wanted to tell us whether they were going to landscape it, whether they're going to make it into a park. We didn't know, but it was there. All right. So it is the land. This is what it looked like before we took over the garden. We took over this piece of wasteland. We also had another problem here because they weren't doing anything about it. It was an eyesore, it's one thing, but the people living around there had a problem with snakes and monitor lizards. And there were pictures, there was always on Facebook, somebody had a monitor lizard climbing up the grills, you know, came back and was met by a monitor lizard. We had to call Bomber to come and catch pythons and all kinds of things. And of course, it was breeding ground for mosquitoes. And because nothing grew there except these old trees and lots of weeds, and what happened sometimes, residents got fed up. They just chopped down whatever they felt they could chop down or burn, which was worse. It killed a lot of the biodiversity in that area. So this was the situation facing that piece of land. Now, at the same time, as residents, we were concerned about global issues like greening the environment, right? And adopting environmentally friendly habits We felt that we were not doing enough for the environment as individuals and as a community. Okay, we have parklands, but what about the environment around your area? What are you going to do about it? What was DBKL doing about it? Right? The city council. It was only not that long ago that they decided that there will be certain days that they would take our stuff for recycling, but before that, everything just went to the dumpster. And prior to us taking over that piece of land, there was also a talk of actually building an incinerator about 10 kilometers from Taman Tun Dr Ismail. And we were horrified because the last thing we want was an incinerator, right? It consumes a lot of energy. We don't know what kind of gases it's going to emit. Yeah, the kind of pollution it was going to cause. We didn't want that. And we felt that there were better ways of protecting our environment, especially Taman Tun Dr Ismail, which is a, so many residents, and we needed parkland and things like that. So as concerned citizens, therefore, we felt that something needed to be done, but we couldn't wait for the local council to do something about it. And of course, there was the issue of food security. Now, at that point in 2017, we just heard whispers about food security. We didn't actually the importance of food security until the MCO, which I'm going to talk about later. Okay, but we were starting to hear things about food security. But what was closer to reality for us was that food prices was going up, and also we were paying a lot for vegetables that were coming from Cameron Highlands, which was full of pesticides. So you're talking about paying a lot for food. You're talking about paying for food that was not actually very good for you, but that left us with very little choice. And the third thing that we were concerned about was this. There was talk about building incinerators, okay, and landfills, but the local council was not doing anything about how we're going to recycle food waste. And you know that if you throw your food waste into your bins, it's going to attract a lot of rats. It's going to, you know when a dumpster is, the people are passing by to collect the rubbish because you can smell them, right? Because households were, they had nowhere to throw their food waste. They were throwing just into the rubbish bag, and then people collect, and then your rubbish bag bursts, and then you leave a trail of this foul smelling liquid. So we didn't want that. We felt that as concerned citizens, we could do something, and we didn't want to wait. Now, so who was going to do? Is there anybody who's going to do anything about it? So it started with this person. The founding chairperson is Margaret Lee. She's still the chairperson of the Taman Tun Dr Ismail Community Garden. Standing next to her is a slave that looks like her. Okay, and people mistaken us for twins. I'm the secretary. So she had all this kitchen waste, and her house happens to be very near to this piece of wasteland. And she's thinking, is there a place I can throw my kitchen waste and turn it into something useful? So it started with an individual who had this thought. Now, Margaret Lee, number one, is not a gardener. Margaret Lee doesn't know anything about gardening, neither does she know anything about composting, okay? But she had this concern, a very real concern, about what to do with food waste, how do we do something about it that we could actually give back, and something that was environmentally friendly. So all these thoughts were running through our heads, and then we decided, okay, let's try and throw it in, and see how we can recycle it. So that was how the TDDI Edible Community Garden was born. Why we call it edible? Because it's not an edible community, but we are talking about planting edibles. That's what she wanted. She wanted to call it an edible garden, okay? Because there were other plans. So we, instead of waiting for the city council to do something or the local council to do something, nobody was interested in rubbish, okay? Nobody was interested in food waste except us. So we thought we have to do something about it. And who are the people? Who are we? Now, when I refer to we, the people who started were mainly retirees like ourselves, above 60, gray hair, not able to do many things, but we had time on our hands. And we decided that, hey, let's get together as friends and let's do something. Okay. And what I want to highlight here in my talk today also, you're never too old to drive the change if you are passionate about that. Okay. So we started with very simple things like we got from Alam Flora some green dustbins and rubbish bags are easily available. And we just spread to word of mouth to WhatsApp, right? Telling our friends and neighbors, hey, if you've got kitchen waste, please donate it to the garden, right? How are we going to recycle it? Okay, we didn't have this master plan, but everything was a learning process for us. And that's how we brought change in the community. So people brought their garden waste, people brought their food waste. And yeah, so I have some pictures here to show you. So we had this bin. So there's a lady here, as you can see, in her nice little handbag. She would have a Tupperware of her kitchen waste from yesterday, and she put into our bins. Now, we also at one time, because we didn't have enough people to give us their kitchen waste, we needed that. Can you imagine when you tell people, I want your kitchen waste? Isn't it wonderful? And yet people were not so enthusiastic. What the hell do they want to do with it? Okay, never mind. So we actually asked, if there's a wet market in Taman Tun. So we actually went into the wet market, just like Alam Flora, collected bags of this discarded vegetables and greens, and we took it back to the garden. Now, if you look here, yeah, we didn't even have a proper container to put the kitchen waste. We just had this wire netting that we could afford or recycle, and we made bins and we put our stuff there. So it started with that. Right now, we don't need it because we have enough people donating. Now, the other thing that we were concerned about was also how do people dispose their used cooking oil? All right. This was something we were worried because we have a river running through Taman Tun Dr Ismail, Sungai Pencala. Okay, actually runs through. And you can see all kinds of rubbish floating in there. Sometimes we see a python swimming in there as well. But you can also see this oily surface. And I'm not sure if you remember many years ago, you can also see videos of people actually opening up drains and all that and scooping this used cooking oil and God knows what to do with it after that. Anybody like from restaurants in China, and we were horrified because we realized that in the many of the restaurants in Taman Tun, they were just throwing the used cooking oil down the drain. So we decided we're going to do something. What we're going to do? Okay, next step, never mind. But we provided containers. Yeah. Yes. So we provided containers for people to discard their used cooking oil. And then we contacted companies that actually paid us for used cooking oil. Okay. Right. So this is just a picture to show what we put outside the garden. We had a bin for waste, food waste, but we didn't want things like meat, bones, dairy products, and of course, no plastics. We also collected coffee grounds because coffee grounds are very valuable for composting. And we have many cafes in Taman Tun Dr Ismail, including Starbucks, which didn't know what to do with the coffee grounds. And we have bags of coffee grounds coming in. And this is the container for used cooking oil. So what I'm going to say is that here is that you can ask people to do something. Say, hey, don't throw your cooking oil down the drain. And then she said, what do I do with it? But you also need to be the drivers for change if you want to see a change. So if you tell people to do something, then you have to provide some kind of facility for them to discard food waste or tell them, okay, if you have this bin, you can put in your coffee grounds or this container, you can put your used cooking oil. So we provide that in our garden. Okay. Now, so the other thing we had also complaints. Now, I think one of the things Malaysians are very good at is complaining. Okay. I started a security scheme in my area because we had a lot of burglaries at one time. And I get complaints about snakes. I get complaints about squirrels. I get complaints about rats. I was even asked to help a neighbor get rid of a snake, which is not my problem, but I said people are very good at complaining. And we get a lot of complaints, that hey, can you call the council or local council and ask them to take away all these plastic bags of dried leaves that they swept. You know how they sweep, they collect.
Yeah.
And sometimes they don't come and collect for a week or two. And what happens? Rainwater collects. You just need a little bit of rainwater for mosquito to breed. And Taman Tun Dr Ismail, posh or nice as it is, we are one of the top places where in KL that has dengue. So we are very concerned. Okay. But if you complain, nothing is going to move. So what did we do? We decided we will collect the bags. So can you imagine your boot will be full of bags of dry leaves, which we then take to the garden. But later on, we had actually, we worked with Alam Flora. So we started collecting. Then Alam Flora workers saw us collecting the bags and said, Miss, do you want them? We said, yes, we need them. We got to know the contractor. So later we worked with Alam Flora and said, can you give us your leaves? And they were very happy because if they bring the leaves to our garden, it means that they don't have to do so many runs to go and dump wherever they are, wherever this place. Yeah, they just... So it saved them a lot of work as well. So they were very happy in the end to bring leaves to us, which we actually need for composting. Now here again, there's a picture of this. As I said, if you look at this, very amateurish, because we were just experimenting and we were actually physically turning the compost just using a bamboo stick or something like that, covering the compost with plastic sheets, but actually learning from ground level. Later on, when we got a bit smarter and we visited, talked to farmers, talked to people who are doing composting, we built this composting pits. So it's about 6 pits. So rubbish goes, waste, leaves goes into this first, gets turned every 2 weeks, then the next pit, and finally it becomes black gold. We call it our black gold because what you discard actually comes by pit 6, it becomes this. And this is worth a lot of money. We sell it back to the community. In fact, for some people, especially the pensioners, we just give them some compost if they want some. If they donate some to the garden, we give them a bit of compost. So it's a nice way of showing our appreciation to the community. What you see here in this picture are people like ourselves, who those pensioners who can squat, will squat and fill up bags of compost, which we then sell. And our compost is very laku. Huh? You have to reserve how many bags of compost you want, because it takes at least about 6 weeks to 2 months, depending on the weather, depending on temperature, to get it to this state where it looks like this. It doesn't even look, you won't even see your carrot or your tomato in there. It's all been composted, right? Yeah, I'll talk about that later. Christian time. Okay. Now, then what about the used cooking oil? Later, we worked with Alam Flora for the collection of used cooking oil. We also work with companies that pay us, I think now we're getting about $3 per kilo of used cooking oil, which is turned into biodiesel. So it's recycled, right? But sometimes you have people who say, look, I've got this used cooking oil at home. I'm too lazy to bring to your garden to dispose. What do I do with it? So we ran a soap making workshop. You can actually make soap from your used cooking oil. Of course, you may not want to use this to wash your face, this soap, because you look at it, it reminds you of your used cooking oil that you used to fry goreng pisang or something like that. May not do wonders for your skin. But you can use the soap for just ordinary cleaning. Maybe you want to wash your dog with it, I'm not sure. But anyway, we have people coming in to teach us. You see, this is what the used cooking oil look like. This is the end product. Isn't that wonderful? And I think for me, it's for people to see that transformation. How waste or what this you want to discard can actually be turned into something useful. And that to me is empowerment. It's empowering you to do something for the environment. You don't have to wait for the environmentalists to say, go and protest or talk about something, but you can do something. So then, once the garden was more established and we actually had a barn built, we told residents about what was happening. A lot of people didn't know that there was a community garden, because that part of Taman Tun is, if you don't live in that part, you hardly go there. So we told people the garden, so we got a lot of visitors, especially the residents themselves, and we created opportunities to talk about how we could create a cleaner and greener living space for everybody. It's not just for ourselves. We're not doing this for money or for fame, but we wanted to create a cleaner and greener living space for you, for your children, for your grandchildren, right? So that was how we educated first the community, but now we don't have a problem because we get people outside the community visiting us. Now, when they come and visit, sometimes they also want to learn about composting. So here we have Mr. Kanil, who is in his 70s. He's our main person to do composting. He has got it down to a fine art. He knows the proportion of greens to browns that you need to put in, when to turn the compost, etc. And we share knowledge with those who are interested and encourage residents to also do their own composting in the garden. But of course, in the garden, you cannot build a composting pit. So we ran workshops. So yours truly was conducting workshops for residents and people, telling them how to create a composting bin, telling them how to do composting in your own garden. So that was education, because we believe that if you educate people, then change will come. But if you don't give people knowledge, it's very hard to change people's mindset. So seeing is believing. Doing is seeing the results of what you believe in. Okay? And very importantly, children. So there are kindergartens in our area. And we contacted the kindergartens and said, look, we've got a garden here. Would you like to bring children to see what real plants look like? Not what you see in your picture books. And you'd be surprised, huh? Most of these children have never seen what a papaya tree look like, what are herbs, what are weeds. When they first came, they're very excited. They pull out everything. These are actually marigolds that we planted. They're not weeds, but they thought they were. So it was educating children and educating them to identify plants. So it was also a very good way of planting this idea of wanting a cleaner and greener environment in the young, right? And we ran workshops for children, believe it or not. We taught them how to sow seeds, right? So, and we taught them that it's okay to touch soil. It's not dirty, you know, it's not smelly. I know parents were concerned about germs and all that. I think they're so concerned about germs. Actually, germs come to us. We don't go look for them. All right. Children learn how to sow seeds. The parents got involved. They also started to learn because they didn't know anything about sowing seeds. And the older children, of course, we got them to sow seeds. And then they took these trays of seeds that we sowed, took them home, took them to school, learned to look after them, learned to care for them, and seeing plants grow. Now, if you don't know where your food comes from, you will never appreciate how difficult it is to grow food. We learned the hard way also that it's not easy to grow vegetables. And we became more appreciative of that. So we wanted to drive also a change in the young people. And we want the kids to learn that growing food is hard work. So as you can see here, we got them not just to plant, but to help in, you know, putting up bamboo poles and whatever we needed. And schools got to know about us. They came to us. They wanted to learn about composting, so we are teaching them. We talked to them. We ran workshops for them. We also go to schools to show them how to do composting. So some schools around who knew what we did also invited us. We had young volunteers. These are mainly from the universities, right? Who had to do their social outreach or whatever, or volunteerism. Now it's part of the curriculum. So we get them coming on weekends to help us. Simple things like housing. Many people have never seen watermelons growing, you know, on the ground and harvesting them, how to harvest your watermelons, how to water, how to mulch. So these were skills that they picked up and they thoroughly enjoyed themselves, right? So you don't watch things on phone anymore, you actually get your hands dirty. So we have actually, this is statistics from 2021. We have more than 1,000 people who have come to learn from us. We have involved more than 300 volunteers, I think easily 500. Now, I think this is a scene we always remember, MCO. People could not get food, right? People queuing up for food. So food security then became a real issue. So what do we do? First, as a community, we help those in need. So the island flora workers have been giving us their leaves and all that. We felt it was time we could reach out. We could actually change the mindset. We are not here just to mind grow things, that we are also giving back to the community. So we gave them food, we gave them masks. And what was a game changer for us, farmers actually contacted us. Now, if you remember during MCO, you couldn't cross boundary, okay? So we couldn't cross states. Taman Tun Dr Ismail is under Kuala Lumpur. So the farmers were in Rawang, which is Selangor. The farmers were in Kinchang, which is also Selangor. Their produce was stuck. They couldn't, and Taman Tun is very near to, we're just at the border. We wanted the fruits. We wanted the vegetables. They couldn't cross. So what do we do? Now, we are a community garden. We have the space. So a farmer contacted us. Sungai Buloh Hospital is under Selangor. It's an infectious disease hospital, and a lot of COVID patients went there, right? We could go to the hospital because you're going to the hospital, right? So meeting point can be the hospital. So we actually bought a whole harvest of pineapples at one time, as you can see here, which we donated actually to the frontliners, to the hospital staff, but some, of course, we took back to sell as well. We also made a whole lot of donations to the Sungai Buloh frontliners because they were working non-stop. They're looking after COVID patients. Their morale was very low because they were so tired. We wanted to show that we cared about them. The community in Taman Tun wanted to show that we cared. How do you show? And how to help the farmers? So it was a win-win situation. We bought the harvest from the farmers. We donated to the hospital. What you can see here, not very clear, are guavas, huge guavas, and sweet corn. So things which could be, and the sweet corn, they are so good, you can actually eat them raw. Okay? So we did that for the hospitals. And then after MCO was what? Floods. Okay. Again, as a community, we felt the government was too slow. We cannot wait for MPs to tell us what to do. We cannot wait for the minister to tell us what to do. We have people asking us, what can we do? And we ask ourselves, what can we do? So we stopped gardening. It was raining anyway. So we turned our community garden into a collection center for items for those who were affected by floods. And we had volunteers, especially Muda, coming in to tell us that we don't have anything, but we've got people who can drive. So these items were donated to places as far as Pulau Keri, where the orang asli were, who were not getting anything. We didn't want to donate to places where, like Shah Alam, everybody was donating to Shah Alam. We went up to Mentakap, right? We went up to Bentong, Raup, those areas, and a lot of it were kampungs. So people who went were volunteers who passed the kampung, they saw, hey, this kampung has nothing. They took the items, they told us what they needed, they come and collect, and it went on for, I think, about 2 weeks, okay? Now, so the garden has given us food. So what I'm showing here is not something I've taken from the internet, but it's actually from our garden, what we've actually managed to grow, okay? We experimented, we failed, we also had successes. But what was important, the biodiversity returned to the piece of land that we nurtured. We've got butterflies, we've got birds, we've got monkeys, we've got insects. A tortoise even came, God knows from where somebody put it there, we don't know, but he came anyway. And most importantly, we changed the community. So when you talk about, to me, when you talk about government policies, about the unity government, about Mandani, what do you translate that to ordinary folks like us? What do you mean by building a community? How do we build community? How do we foster unity? So our garden became a place where we would organize events and the community would come together. They got to know one another. They didn't know, people didn't know, hey, I didn't know you're my neighbor. Hey, I didn't know you lived down the road. All right. So there was a sense of community, a sense of belonging. And because of this, fostering unity, sharing knowledge, we also promoted this idea that as a community, as an individual, you can bring about a change. And that is actually empowerment for us. And we also link up with other community gardens because more and more came up during the MCO. And we also work with other gardens who are actually concerned about other things. For example, this one in PJ, they are very concerned about water quality because a river runs through their taman as well. All right. And they want to clean up the area. So we work with them. We have a kind of knowledge sharing sessions and you know how to get funding from your MPs, how to get that's empowerment, how to get work with NGOs, how to talk to people in city hall, who to contact. So all these are little things, but very important if you want to empower citizens to bring about a change. And this is just a bit of advertisement. We have won awards for the work we've done. In 2019, we won the Gold Award from people who didn't want to work for with us at first, DBKL, right? Because they look at us as a bunch of senior citizens with gray hair, didn't know anything about gardening, right? So, oh, what can they do? Can they hold a chango? Okay, we persisted, we showed them, we invited our MP Hannah Yeo to see our garden. We invited people from Jabatan Landscape Negara to show that we can do also a good job at landscaping. And then they told us about the competition we entered. We won the gold. We also, then after that, other gardens started competing with us. Then we also won one which was an ASEAN award. We were actually placed as being one of those who were one of the finalists. We didn't win, but we were one of the finalists. And this was an ASEAN award. So I think that says a lot. So that's the end of my talk. Sorry if I've spoken too long, but I just wanted to say what Mary has said earlier, that yes, you may think that to be citizenship empowerment means must go and just demonstrate, must always work with the MPs, must always work with politicians. No, we can be the drivers for change. So in this case, we did the reverse. We did make the change first. Then we told DBKL, this is what we can do. Now, remember, this piece of land belongs to the city council. So they have every right to take the land from us anytime, right? Just as what they've done to the farmers in Perak, in Tambun recently, right? They can say, yeah, doing something illegal. So we wanted to prove, we wanted this land to stay. We don't want them to take the land back for development. But to do that, we have to put effort to make a change and to show, to demonstrate that you can do something with this piece of land other than just building something else, right? We didn't want another building in our taman. And that, I felt that to me, I learned a big lesson that yes, we have to be the drivers of change, not just wait for the politicians to tell you what to do. So that's the end of my talk. Thank you very much.